Good morning. My name is Curtis Desselles, and today we have our honor. We are honored to present Vanessa Niemann from Gal Holiday and the band. And I'm just going to turn it over to you right now and let you talk about it.
Okay. Sure. Thank you.
Okay.
well, this is my first time doing this, so I'm honored to be asked to do something like this. I wanted to really talk about, we have a lot of times we have people ask us why we play country music or how we play country music out of a city like New Orleans. And so I became curious about the connection with South Louisiana and country music. Mm-hmm. A lot of people know about the Northern Louisiana connection, the Louisiana Hayride, of course, and Shreveport's connection. And, of course, we had our two-term governor back in the day, Mr. Jimmy Davis.
Jimmy Davis, right.
Yes, who was...
You Are My Sunshine.
Yes, he really, he got elected on country music, basically.
That's
and
right.
You Are My Sunshine, a song that was actually written by Oliver Hood from LaGrange, Alabama, LaGrange, Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody knows about Jerry Lee Lewis. And more modern day, we have Kix Brooks from Shreveport. Of Brooks and Dunn, and Tim McGraw from Start, Louisiana, Trace Adkins, Hank Jr., was born in Shreveport. But South Louisiana connection is more interesting to me because it's where I live. And I have a lot of friends who are in Cajun bands and everything too, and there's been a very strong Cajun country connection in South Louisiana for a long time. As we all know, there's also this connection to the Germans who brought the accordion, to South Louisiana and Texas.
The German coast, which was close to where you are.
Yes, exactly. I'm from Maryland originally. I came down. And so this is really a big, this is really a big part when we start to talk about South Louisiana and New Orleans specifically. It's been a place where people have come historically for many, many years to work on the railways and then during World War II to work on the Higgins boats in the largest boat manufacturing factory in the United States down in New Orleans. But the Cajuns have been loving country music for a very long time.
Oh, yeah. I grew up with it myself, you know.
Yes,
and
of course.
I'm from Marksville, Louisiana.
We were just talking about that.
That's right.
And Jimmy Davis's, there's all these interesting connections to me. Jimmy Davis's campaign piano player that played mm-hmm. with him was Moon Mullican, who had his own band as well. But Moon Mullican actually co-wrote the lyrics for Jambalaya with Hank Williams, which I didn't know. And there are a couple of marvelous articles that happened when I started doing the research that actually come from the Louisiana Folklife Center right here at
exactly.
NSU.
It's pretty good, right?
Yes, exactly. So I feel like I'm sort of just digging up old information, bringing it to light again. And then Jimmy Davis himself co-wrote Bayou Pompon, which was a
big
Hank
hit
Williams hit as well. And then we do Cajun Baby. We'll do that again in our show
okay.
a little bit later on.
Now, did you know that where I'm from in Avalos Parish, Jimmy Dunlap, you know who that is? Loretta Lynn's piano player.
Okay, yes.
So there you go, another connection to the middle part of Louisiana and the South.
That's right, and country music stars have been coming to Cajun country for a long time, too.
Mm-hmm.
There's a little bar out in Mamou called The Holiday.
Okay.
And I know, it's called The Holiday. I think we had to put a dance on there. Gal
Holiday
should put a dance. But The Holiday has had Loretta Lynn and George Jones, and it's just a little tiny bar. I mean, this was like in the 1960s they mm-hmm. came through. But, the Cajuns are big appreciators. And it goes forward, too, to today. I mean, Jimmy C. Newman's band, mm-hmm. Cajun Country, and then Doug Kershaw, of course, and then Joel Savoie.
Sammy Kershaw.
Yeah, Sammy Kershaw and Joel Savoie. He has a little label called Valcour Records,
mm-hmm.
And he put out an album that's wonderful called Joel Savoie's Honky Tonk Merry-Go-Round. It's got Kelly Jones Savoie on there, and Courtney Granger, who plays with the Pine Leaf Boys, has a marvelous country voice. You'd never know it from him standing back and being all quiet back there.
Well, we have some hidden gems in Louisiana.
It's true. And then, of course, Yvette Landry.
Mm-hmm.
So you have all of these people. So, that's sort of that. But I really, wanted to sort of answer the question, what is country music?
Well, that's a good question. Anyone can give us maybe an answer? What do you think? What is country? Well, that's okay. Anything you say.
What is country music?
We'll involve the audience just briefly.
Yeah.
So,
country is just music of the people, probably for me, but how
yes,
about you?
Yes, it is music of the people. In fact, I tell my boyfriend's little boy, he's two, when I'm going to do a show, I'm going to play music for the people.
So, you see that?
Yeah,
great.
Yeah, and I have another friend out in Texas who's, you know, whose sort of slogan for his band is Music for the People. And that really is what it is. It's a retroactive label, though. Country music used to be called hillbilly music. Mm-hmm. That was the way that it was called, or it was gospel music in the Carter family.
Country
families.
And Western, which was
yes.
two separate music, basically.
Yes, but, you know, country music is sort of a retroactive label that's applied to this style of music that's a mixture of string bands, vocal music, primarily from the South, but not always. Mm-hmm. We discussed this as well. There are some great bands that come out of the Pacific Northwest and the Midwest. And Vermont and the Northeast.
And your band, of course, is from, you know, you're from Maryland, so it's
originally,
still a great band.
Yes, originally from Maryland, but I did start my band in New Orleans. And so country music kind of came in the 1940s, replacing the term hillbilly music, mm-hmm. because it sounded...
derogatory.
Probably. Yeah, it sounded a little, even though I am from the hills, and we like to be called hillbillies
that's right.
over there. But so... I guess, you know, this sort of really goes into this article. I really kind of want to reference it first. This is most of this information that is from an article from 2005 from the Louisiana Folklife Festival booklet.
Imagine that.
I know, 2005. So I'll talk a little bit about that, and then I sort of want to play some clips of some of this music, the old stuff, and then sort of take it into modern and talk about what is going on in New Orleans now and how that relates and why that's happening.
That's great.
So so very early on, Alan Lomax, of course, went around and did all of these folkways traditions, recording all of these old, you know, all these old timers who, you know, he took his little microphone around and all these wonderful recordings that he has. He talked to Jelly Roll Morton in 1939 in New Orleans. And Morton described, this is a quote from the article, Morton described the black and Creole serenading string bands. There's the term, string bands, active in the city of New Orleans prior to 1900, and the vocal quartets that sang spiritual numbers, primarily for funerals and wakes, which is still something that you have. But this is, you know, this is string bands and vocal quartets, which is sort of like, you know, one of the foundations of country music. Mm-hmm. He also singles out the work of one Kid Ross, an outstanding white player of hot piano in the Storyville district around 1910. And apparently Kid Ross later showed up on some country music recordings. So the first recordings that came out, April 1927, the first identified country music recording session in New Orleans is from April 1927. The first of several sessions at the OK Record Company, which is very famous for putting out Cab Calloway and all kinds of things.
Okay.
But it was there was a song recorded by the Leake County Revelers from Mississippi. And then the very next year, the Leake County Revelers recorded a song called Make Me a Pallet on the Floor, but their version is called Make Me a Bed on the Floor. Mm-hmm. And that's a song that's been popular with New Orleans musicians of all different kinds, mm-hmm. black and white, of all different styles for many, many years. So I thought we would play just a little snippet of this scratchy,
great.
Scratchy recording. April 27, 1928.
Yes, ma'am. At that time, did they have accordion music then?
I believe the accordion was already down.
From the Germans earlier.
From the German influence earlier. I imagine the 1800s was when the Germans...
Back in the early 1800s.
Okay.
Yeah, and, you know, I don't really know if it had found its way into Cajun and Zydeco, but I imagine it had.
It just barely had started around that area because the migrations happened in the late 1700s, 1785, around
mm-hmm.
there. So it took a few years just for it to come down. But
I mean, I think of country music as with accordion music.
Yes, it certainly is. I mean, it certainly is very tied in.
And the guitar, basically.
Yeah, the stringed bands, you know, and I think the accordion for me is very prevalent, especially in Texas country music, where mm-hmm. you have a lot of Tejano kind of influence, a lot of Mexican influence, and the Mexicans, again,
yeah,
got
the cantina,
accordion
whatever,
yeah. from the Germans. So, but this is a very, this has no accordion. It's a very scratchy old recording, and we'll see if we can get the volume right here.
You know what that sounds like? Allons dans ce calendar. It's an old French music.
Really, that's what this was?
No, it's not, but it sounds the same kind of beat.
Oh, yeah.
Allons dans ce calendar, you know.
True.
Well, and then we're going to talk about, and this is, you know, and this is the thing, too. I'm going to play another clip right here. The very first Cajun music recording was also recorded in New Orleans on that same day. By, yes, on that very same day, by Joe and Cleoma Falcon. So they must have set up a recording session, and people came down. Yeah, Falcon. Okay, thank you. And New Orleans actually became the leading city in the leading city world. I mean, you know, in South Louisiana.
Right.
For recording Cajun music. And of course, Cajun music at that time was also very tinged with the Western swing influence, the Hackberry Ramblers, you know, being...
What was his wife's name?
Falcon?
No, his wife.
Oh, Cleoma. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Joe and Cleoma.
Cleoma.
So, is that how you say it?
Yeah, Cleoma.
Cleoma.
French.
Cleoma.
French.
I butcher it sometimes. So this
is
the
song. That's okay. I'm from Louisiana, so.
This is the song. It's Allons de Lafayette.
Allons de Lafayette.
Yes.
C'est pour changer mon nom, you know.
Oh, let's see if we can get it to play here.
Me too. Allons de Lafayette. C'est pour changer mon nom. Comment tu vas t'appeler, madame, quand vous commencez?
All right. We're gonna see if we can get it to pull up. But that is on the same day. I don't know. It might be connection problems here.
Okay. We should have good connections here, but.
Yeah, well, I'm hooked up to my...
Oh, your phone, your tether?
Yeah, we might just move on if I can't get it to play.
Okay, well, that's fine. Yeah, but Allons dans ce calendar was a very famous one.
Yeah.
And Allons à Lafayette, pour changer mon... You know, different, the same kind of beat.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm not sure why I'm not getting a connection here, but I'm
maybe
not...
We'll move on.
So,
and
yeah, we'll move on. Sorry about that. Maybe we'll... Maybe
it's
we'll
okay.
get it to the internet to pull up.
It'll pull up in a little while.
Of course. Okay, so then we have that same year of 1928, June. Jimmie Rogers spent
Everybody
a lot of time.
That.
Yep, Jimmie Rogers spent a lot of time coming around New Orleans. He worked for a brakeman on the railways, and he recorded My Little Old Home down in New Orleans. He was not from New Orleans, but he came down and spent a lot of influential time there. He recorded that in June of 1928. And then in 1929, he recorded Hobo Bill's Last Ride in the city of New Orleans.
Wow.
He actually recorded that in New Orleans. And then in 1930, he did recordings with Louis and Lillian Armstrong, who was Louis's wife and a wonderful piano player in his band as well. So this is an example when we talk about New Orleans and how you know, country music and Cajun bands from the region always sort of bring in influences of other styles of music. So this is an example, Jimmie Rogers, this collaboration with Louis Armstrong.
Yeah, New Orleans
collaboration.
Is like a melting pot, not only of people, but of music.
Yeah, so the country music doesn't really, you know, the country music is, you know, very tinged with jazz music, as is the Cajun music with the jazz music. And this might actually be a good time to mention this little email. This is sort of a current thing.
Okay.
So recently I was on the Facebook, as people are these days, and I'm good friends with the Pine Leaf Boys, and Wilson Savoie made a very interesting Facebook post the other day. The band is out touring in California, and he decided to share this letter that he had received from a California Zydeco fan who was disappointed in the performance that she had seen And we all know these people who come from other places and think that when they're coming to Louisiana, what they get at Festival Acadien is exactly what the band does. The Festival Acadien is very, very specific, right? The songs mm-hmm. in French and all of this sort of things. But bands like the Pine Leaf Boys and bands like my band as well in the modern times, we've always played other different styles of music. It's not just strictly Cajun and Zydeco. It's not just strictly country music.
You broaden your horizons, you know?
Yes, yeah, so she was very disappointed in what she says. She loves their songs primarily in Cajun French, but disappointed in their, quote, Americana Acadiana mishmash. And was hoping that the concert the next night would be a little bit truer to their Acadiana culturally rich sound. And in very brief, I won't read his whole response. He says, "The fact is, while we are a band from Louisiana that plays Cajun Zydeco music, we also appreciate and play other kinds of music and enjoy mixing it up, playing the other kinds of music that influence our sound, from country to blues to boogie. And Cajun bands have done this for decades, long before Pine Leaf Boys, from Nathan Absher to Lawrence Walker." So I thought that was a very, very nice response on his part. And I heard that they didn't play any songs in Cajun French the next night.
Just to boot, you know?
Yes, just to boot. But I thought that was very interesting right when I was kind of putting this presentation together, because it does fit into what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. Beyond New Orleans, the jazz influence from New Orleans was a huge influence on the Western swing of Bob Wills. He recorded a lot of jazz songs, actually. He recorded St. James Infirmary, Basin Street Blues, Jelly Roll Blues, Darktown Strutter's Ball, all of these songs that were traditionally jazz songs done in New Orleans. He met up with two other lovers of jazz music, the Brown brothers, Durwood and Milton, who had Milton Brown and the musical Brownies as well. They used jazz soloing and the first electric guitar in Western swing music as well. And they traveled very often to New Orleans and recorded 49 sides in the city, including Sadie Green, the Vamp of New Orleans, and all these other wonderful songs. Now, the interesting thing, the reason I mentioned the Milton Brown and the Brownies, is mm-hmm. that when Milton passed away, Jimmy Davis actually took the lead vocals on a few of their mm-hmm. recordings. So this is this big cyclical.
You see that a lot. And families mix together, you know, and they mm-hmm. they support each other.
Yes,
it's the Louisiana way sometimes, you know. Mm-hmm.
And we'll see now. I think we might have internet again. I can actually maybe play.
Allons à Lafayette.
Would you like to hear Allons à Lafayette?
Yeah, let's try
that.
Okay,
so let's play that one. We're going to jump back here. Jo et Clem Falcon. 1928. I do not understand the French, unfortunately. This is what he's here for, right? To help me.
I was born in, I didn't speak English till I was six.
I had to learn my prayers in English.
I did too.
Yes, yes. Oh yeah, that's that whole generation where French was no, but now I love that this younger generation is bringing this back in bands like Pine Leaf Boys.
And you know, in Louisiana we have three types of French people don't really know. We have colonial French is where I'm from. Mm-hmm. We have Cajun French and Creole French. The closest to the Parisian French, the real pure French, is colonial in this middle of the area, the town, the state. Voyles Parish, St. Landry, you know, places like that. And the French is a lot different. I'm closer to the Parisian French.
Yeah, it's very different from all over the state.
In Marksville, we still have signs in the streets of French and the radio station and the TV. And, you know, so yeah. Anyway, but Continuing.
So, yes, so Jimmy Davis taking the leads on that. And, you know, then you have in New Orleans, you have a lot of Jimmy Rogers imitators.
Oh, yeah.
And also Hank Williams imitators mm-hmm. as well. You know, this is like back in the day, right? So, this is when we start to get into like the 1940s. Jimmy Davis was a Jimmy Rogers sort of right. imitator as well, mm-hmm. along with Jerry Behrens and an Alabaman named Rex Griffin, who relocated to New Orleans, and he was broadcast on WWL, which mm-hmm. I didn't realize had been around for that long. Mm-hmm. So we start to talk about the radio stations, and you start to have all of these you know, all of these folks coming down because of World War II, right? So you have a lot of people coming from other places, which has always happened in a city like New Orleans.
Right.
So now we're talking specifically about New Orleans. We have, you know, radio stations WWL, mm-hmm. WJBW. There was a radio station there where fiddler and bandleader Danny Powell played, and at that time, apparently, he had four or five different country bands working in the city of New Orleans.
The war brought this mixture down.
Yes.
Of the different people with different talent.
Yeah, and you had people. That's right. You had people from Arkansas, Mississippi, Alabama, Texas, northern Louisiana, all coming down to work on the Higgins boats. So there was a much stronger interest and opportunity mm-hmm. for country music to blossom in the city. And of course, then you already had this pre-existing connection between the Cajuns coming down to record in the city and all of the Western swing influence coming over from Texas, Bob Wills and
That's
the Milk.
Right.
So it was really like, you know, primed. The city was primed.
New Orleans was like the Nashville
of the Deep
States.
South. Yeah, right. I mean, it really was. And apparently, this is according to this article by J. Michael Luster from 2005. This is a quote from that article. One disgruntled jazz fan wrote, quote, hillbilly singers and Irish tenors threatened to displace jazz entirely. And this is now, you know, so when people ask, why do you play country music in New Orleans? There really is a precedent for it in the city. It's just been forgotten. So you had all of these wonderful shows. You had knockoff shows for the Louisiana Hayride called the Dixie Barn Dance in New Orleans. You have the Ponchatoula Hayride, the Big Howdy Jamboree in Bogalusa, the Wego Country Opry on the West Bank. And of course, post-World War II, when people were, you know, buying homes and things, a lot of people were moving to the outlying suburban areas outside of the city.
The veterans had a big thing to do with it. When they came back, the government built them houses.
Yes.
And they gave, like Northwestern State here, we had some houses built for veterans to go back to school. And I lived in some until they tore them down. And so you see the longevity of everything, you know?
Yes, exactly. And it is interesting how all of that, you know, how the war really affected people sort of, you know, because, yes, everybody got a house and, you know, it was the veterans.
And even before
right?
the war, we had the Depression. And what happened during the Depression? FDR, the New Deal.
Mm-hmm.
And that what that made was the WPA, the Works Progress Administration. A lot of culture and writings and music
yes.
was all recorded and for posterity. You know?
Yes, the painters, painters and writers.
The archaeologists,
and music.
The whatever, you know.
So WDSU, also, they were the station that hosted the Dixie Barn Dance, hosted by Uncle Roy. An interesting note out of that program, in 1947, one of the local stars was 14-year-old Betty Owens, who later became the featured vocalist with the Dukes of Dixieland, another example of the fluid boundaries between genres in the city. And then there was also a young man named Harold Cavallero, apparently Werlein's Music Store on Canal Street, which is now, there's a big restaurant that's been there for years. He studied with this guy named Roger Filberto, who literally wrote the book on the lap steel guitar. And Harold Cavallero was such a great study at the guitar that he actually ended up playing all around town in many, many different bands. And then he ended up playing, he ended up playing in the house band for the Dixie Barn Dance a little bit later on, in addition to playing at all of these wonderful venues. at like Betty's Tavern on Decatur Street. Ooh, wow. Betty's Tavern. But he played from the time he was a teenager, and it sounded like there were lots of young folks, including the singer Betty Owens.
Now, you basically do a lot of work in New Orleans.
Yes.
Do you see a lot of the old stuff, like you mentioned here, still there today?
Well, so this is where we're moving on to then, right?
Okay,
this
good.
This is the next step. So where are we now with country music in New Orleans? You know, basically what happened was when the 60s and 70s came around, so many people had moved out of the city, country music history, R&B became extremely popular. And then, you know, it was basically by the mid 70s, the history was completely forgotten. Mm-hmm. However, there were a few people still doing, a pedal steel guitar player named Steve Spitz in town was in a band called the Plowboys in the 1980s. So there was a Western swing band in the 80s. And then in the late 90s, you have Kim Carson, who came to Louisiana and was playing country music around in New Orleans. And then my band started in 2004. And there really was not much country music, at least not what I consider traditional sounding country music.
Did you have a good, you were received well when you did it?
So this is what happened, right? Mm-hmm. 2004, we had a big flood in 2005, right? And we went away, and when we came back in September of 2005, we came back, we didn't have any gigs outside of town, so we came back to town to see what we could do to help rebuild and work and play music. Mm-hmm. And we came back to a large mass of contractors from places like Oklahoma and South Dakota.
It was ripe for the...
Yes, and our very first concert back was close to Canal Street, and our almost entire audience were contractors from Oklahoma. There you are, that's right. And so for me, this is a really big parallel to the World War II sort of immigration, where you have people coming from other regions who are country music appreciators.
Right.
So here we go with the priming of all of this. And then you have this resurgence of young people. Now, young people have always come, flocked to the city of New Orleans, but much more so post-Katrina and post-flood, because there was opportunity to,
Before that, it was kind of stagnant.
Yeah, before that, it was, you know, it was sort of locked into what it had become for a while.
Right.
And then everything, you know, got literally sort of, you know,
wiped out.
Just wiped out. So, you know, you have a lot of people coming back with their culture, but then there's also all of this young folks with this renewed interest in train hopping and riding the rails. Mm-hmm. It's like the 1920s all over again. And so you have this, and then you have all of these folks coming to start businesses as well. You know, people with all of these visions
start,
of urban gardening and interest in Cajun culture, because they've seen younger bands like Pine Leaf Boys or, you know, all these other bands who are sort of Red Stick Ramblers or in their, you know, older incarnation, just sort of going around the country. And so people say, you know, oh, let me go down there to New Orleans and see what's going on. So now in the city, I have a list here, which is, I don't even know how many people long this list is. But my friend Jimmy Palacios, I'm actually wearing a t-shirt for this festival that he has coming up. My friend Jimmy Palacios has a show on a new radio station in town. Everybody knows about WWOZ. We have our college radio station, WTUL. There's a new station called WHIV. It's a community awareness station. It was started by the leading infectious diseases doctor at the new medical center that we have there, a guy named Mark Allen Delery. And so this is, you know, it's a station dedicated to social justice and community issues. And it's 102.3 FM. They stream as well. And he has a show on Monday nights. It's called NOLA County. And we all know this is kind of a
NOLA
joke, because we don't have counties in Louisiana. But he actually took it from a country band that was called NOLA County. They changed their name. And he took the name. And he's bringing, in August, he's bringing a slew of bands from all over the country that are in this designation of Ameripolitan, which just very briefly is a designation created in the past 5 years by Dale Watson, from Texas to encompass bands that music that doesn't get much national publicity. So it would be Western swing, honky tonk, outlaw, and rockabilly. And so there's going to be this convergence in New Orleans of country music.
Maybe it'll start a resurgence again.
It is. It really is. And then there's been a wonderful program. Mark Tobler on WTUL has been doing his program for about 20 years, folk and country music. There's also a show called Hayride to Hell on WTUL, which has been going on for a long time. And then we have a big clear channel station down in New Orleans now, Nash FM, which is also very supportive of local music. One day a week they dedicate to playing a lot more local sort of artists. So we have honky-tonk bands now. I'd say there's probably anywhere from like 8 to 15 bands, including Gal Holiday, Ron Hotstream, and Johnny Dilks, and the Hill Country Hounds, and the Swinging Doors. Mm-hmm. And so now, earlier we referenced, right, this one guy, this one fiddle player who had four or five country bands back in the 1940s or 50s, right? Mm-hmm. Four or five country bands. A lot of these bands, there's this guy named John Hatchett, who also plays with Miss Martha and her Good Time Gang, and also with the Wasted Lives. And they also has an old time band. So you have all of these musicians that are sort of playing around with each other and creating this little scene. And a lot of these people came and they bought homes down in the Lower Ninth Ward and in Holy Cross. And across St. Claude Avenue, where you never would really want to buy a home prior to the flood.
Katrina, yeah.
Yeah, so you have, I'd say, 8 to 15 honky-tonk bands. We tried to compile a sort of comprehensive list as we could. And then there's a few Western swing bands. Washboard Chaz has a bunch of different bands. He has one specifically called Washboard Rodeo. And if you're unfamiliar with Washboard Chaz, he's a black musician that moved from Colorado. In the 90s. He was actually the mayor of a small town in Colorado in the 70s. Mm-hmm. And he and his wife moved to New Orleans and raised their children in the city. And he's got he plays the washboard with a little bell that he dings. And he's on lots and lots of people's recordings of all different styles. He plays swing and he plays jazz and all this. But his Western swing band is called Washboard Rodeo, and it's really fantastic. Twin fiddles.
There's so many that people
Nettie
don't
Vaughn
know.
And Matt Rohde, and he's been around for a long time. And then we also have all of these Americana bands, which is a much looser, sort of much more difficult genre to sort of pin down. But you have the Desselles that came out of, her name is escaping me right now, but the Desselles are a great band. Jackson and the Janks, some of these names. Wow. Max and the Martians as well. It's like
that's
1950s
out, right?
Names. I know, far out. And Esther Rose and Lynn Drury. Jason Bishop is great. He plays with Kim Carson. So, and then I also have a whole list, which I wasn't able to put on the sheet because it came into me too late, from Dan Wally Baker. Now, Dan Wally Baker is a guy from Asheville, North Carolina, and he's a teacher. He came down to the city, and he teaches flatfoot clogging in ours and square dancing, which, of course, down in Louisiana, if you grew up in Louisiana, which I did not, but I know a lot of people that did, a lot of people that grew up in Louisiana, they actually were taught in school square dancing.
They were. That's correct.
And hello, Chris. That's our friend Chris from New Orleans. Yes, you found us. So Dan Wally Baker came down, and he hosts, I think, weekly square dances at a church on Claiborne Avenue. And there is a big resurgence of the old-time and bluegrass music as well down in the city, which for me is a completely separate thing. I grew up in bluegrass country, and it's a completely separate thing from the honky-tonk, what I consider the honky-tonk music and the country music. But often the bands will do dances together, so you might have an old-time band playing the early set, and then a country band playing. And there are a number of people that have pretty much every night of the week. You can find country music in the city. Did you have a question?
Yeah, on a Monday night in New Orleans, St. Claude, a place called the High Ho Lounge.
That's right.
Every Monday is a bluegrass jam session.
That's right. Every Monday night, and it's been going on. It's called the Bluegrass Country Picking Party at the High Ho Lounge on St. Claude Avenue, and they sit around, and there's a lot of people that come, and they do that. I know there's also a bluegrass, there's also an old-time sort of jam that happens on Bayou St. John. I don't know what night of the week that is, but it happens on the bridge right there over the bayou in mid-city, and everybody gets together and jams. Yeah, it might be. And then there is also, during the season, which is not the summer, of course, the season being about September, middle of September, mm-hmm. until just after Jazz Fest, mm-hmm. There's a Tuesday night that is looking actually for a new home for this year. But Joy Patterson and Matt Bell, their band, The Wasted Lives, host this night called the All-Star Covered Dish Country Jamboree. And it's, you know, their idea was to take it back to these old style, like the Louisiana Hayride or any of these Hayride knockoffs. So people bring a covered dish to share, and you get a discounted entry for bringing food to share with everybody. And it's been in a couple different places. It will move in this fall, for the fall. We're not sure where. And they usually start off the night with a... with an acoustic or a small duo or trio, and then two other bands, and they have usually either a dance lesson or a joke-telling contest or a hollering contest.
Just like a long time
or
ago.
Or just, yes, they also do an auction, so if you bring something to auction off, they sometimes have an actual auctioneer there. So it's a good time if you find yourself in the city.
The good old days.
That's right. And then there's also a Thursday night Americana Jam at D-Max, and a Thursday night ABC, which is Americana Bluegrass Country Night at Bank Street. And then that's in addition to the Cajun and Zydeco nights that happen all over the city. The big Zydeco night, of course, being Rock and Bowl on the Thursday, and then Cajun Sundays at Rock and Bowl as well with Bruce D'Agrapont. He moved it from to Patinas. So now the city is just really flush with country music musicians, and a lot of them leave during the summer. And they go travel around and
they
tour
back,
around, and they come back. And it's really interesting to see how many bands, because again, when we started with Gal Holiday, it was us and Kim Carson, and you know, some other stuff that I don't really consider country, more like rock and country
but
stuff.
But you were pure country.
That was pretty much it that was operating inside the city, and now we have, you know, I don't know, 50 to 60 other bands that are playing around.
Well, very good. We're kind of winding down. We have a few minutes left, and 5 minutes left. So maybe we can see if someone has questions for you.
Sure.
Anybody have questions? Could you tell us a little bit about maybe, go ahead, sir.
Did I miss where you came from and how you came into country music? So I've seen you quite a few times over many hairstyles.
Yes, many hairstyles.
Yes.
Yes, so I came down in late 1999 from Maryland. I grew up in Western Maryland in bluegrass country. We were discussing this a little bit earlier. You know, bluegrass music is all up and down the Appalachians, the stringed music of the Scots-Irish and the Germans. My grandparents raised my mother in Baltimore, which Baltimore has the oldest, still continuing, I believe, bluegrass station in the country. So I grew up in the western part in the mountains, with my music-loving mother, grew up falling asleep on bales of hay at barn dances quite often on the weekends. Mm-hmm. So music was always in my blood. And country music for me became a little bit later obsession. My grandparents, of course, listened to everything that was on the radio and during their time, so it was a mishmash of things. I didn't really discover country music until I started listening to rockabilly music with Johnny Cash, and realizing that that's actually, you know, country music as well. And then just became interested and started listening to Western swing.
Well, that's a good question. Anybody else? Anybody else want
to? New Orleans.
Yeah, so I was working for a designer from a fashion designer who was opening a store in the city, and they asked me to come, but it had been a place I had wanted to, I just didn't have the money. So my grandparents would come to New Orleans in the 60s and the 70s, and they would tell me about how wonderful it was. Oh, okay. When ladies still wore long dresses, and they would ride the streetcar to go have a drink at the Columns, a drink and dinner at the Columns on St. Charles. And my father came for a couple of conferences in the 80s and would bring me back beads. And actually, funny enough, my mother was a single mom until I was about 4 and a half, and she played music. And she actually came down to busk on the streets in Jackson Square when I was just a little baby.
So it's in your blood.
Yeah, so I didn't even know that until later on. She brought me down here when I was about 6 months old.
Well, your band, Gal Holiday, and we know you're playing here, but what are you playing your next gigs? Maybe someone will want to catch you.
Sure, yeah, we're actually, we have some great things coming around. I mean, we're playing also in Baton Rouge coming up in October. We just did a Hank Williams tribute. In New Orleans. We did one in Lafayette as well with the Rayo Brothers, and we have that coming to Baton Rouge in October, to the Dyson House Listening Room. And we have a great website too. All of the dates are on there. August 5th is a big exciting show in New Orleans though, where Wanda Jackson, who some of you may know, I think one of her most famous songs probably is Fujiyama Mama, which she did, a rockabilly song. But she was one of Elvis's girlfriends, long time ago. And she's just wonderful. She's still performing, and she sounds as great as ever. So we're actually opening for her.
Okay, great.
At Tipitina's on August 5th. And then there is this big festival that's happening. It's an indoor festival, though, so air-conditioned. August 19th in New Orleans, called the Ameripolitan Festival. And there's going to be three bands from New Orleans, and then a bunch of bands from Portland and Seattle and Denver and Texas and all of these places coming to the city.
Well, we're sorry it has to come to an end, but
I know.
We appreciate you coming, Vanessa.
And, thank you.
We'd like to have you back again.
I'd love to come back again. And I was nervous.
And
but
thank
this
you.
Is
you
great.
Did a
thank
great
you.
Job. Let's give her a hand.
Thank you.